Hello and welcome to Forum. The European Commission has unveiled its proposed tobacco products directive aimed at reducing the numbers of deaths from smoking-related diseases, which, according to the Commission, currently stands at between 250,000 and 750,000 a year. The new proposal, likely to be adopted next year and to come into force in 2015 or 16, tightens up the rules on the manufacture, marketing and sale of tobacco products, and it follows a long public consultation. It's claimed that the bulk of the 85,000 responses came from the tobacco industry or its affiliates. Principally, what most smokers will notice is that warnings, including fairly lurid and shocking pictures, will occupy 75% of the surface areas, front and back, on packs of cigarettes and hand-rolling tobacco, which must otherwise be plain. Makers can still place brand names on them, but only with a single standardized typeface and color, no logo, in other words. Well, the size and shape of the pack will be regulated too, probably outlawing packs of fewer than 20 cigarettes. There are other tweaks to the law too, which we'll go into shortly, with bans on flavourings and rules about the minimum thickness of cigarettes even. Let me introduce my guests. First of all, long-serving German EPP member Karl-Heinz Florenz. We also have a socialist MEP from Denmark, Christel Schaldemose. Welcome to you both. Representing the tobacco industry is Ronan Barry of British American Tobacco, BAT. And finally, last but not least, Flaminia Consuelo Triglia, who runs the Brussels office of the European Confederation of Tobacco Retailers. Firstly, let's just take a quick taste of opinions around the table here, if I may, on what, if anything, what sort of effect do you think this new legislation is likely to have? Karl-Heinz Florenz first.
Also ich glaube, es ist richtig, dass die Europäische Kommission an der Tabakfrage weiterarbeitet. Wir verlieren in meinem Land jeden Tag 300 Menschen an Tabakerkrankungen. Bei der Frage der Produkte und der Gestaltung von Produkten muss man sehen, wie sich die Diskussion in dem Europäischen Parlament entwickelt. Ich möchte mich mal daran erinnern, dass die Kommission einen Vorschlag macht, aber die Kommission entscheidet nicht. Das machen wir und der Rat. Und kein Bericht geht so heraus, wie er reingekommen ist. Einige Punkte gefallen mir sehr gut, zum Beispiel die Frage, dass endlich diese Chemikalien verboten werden in den Zigaretten und viele andere Sachen. Das oberste Gebot muss sein, junge Menschen nicht zum Rauchen zu bringen.
Ronan Barry, can I come to you next? I mean, do you feel that this legislation will have an impact on, for instance, on sales and distribution and indeed on health?
I think actually I'd like to maybe kick off by clarifying the position that my company comes from in this whole debate, and it is that we recognise that smoking is a public health problem and that there are serious health consequences attached to it. We therefore think we expect that, and we think it's right that governments take action to reduce tobacco-related disease, and in particular to reduce tobacco consumption amongst minors. Where we have difficulty is when measures are proposed or introduced that without reducing overall consumption or without reducing disease are disruptive of the legal market, in particular when measures come forward that shift demand or shift consumption from the legal market into the illegal channel. And in that context, I think there are some problems with the proposal from the Commission. If I could just give one example or a couple of examples, there's a proposed ban on so-called slim cigarettes and menthol cigarettes. Now, cumulatively, there are 14 million smokers in the European Union, almost 14 million smokers that consume those products. That's 14 million people on whom a product ban is being imposed. So if that's not a massive opportunity for, you know, pretty nasty people involved in cigarette smuggling, pretty violent people, if that's not a massive opportunity for them, I don't know what it is. I don't think anyone would doubt that those people are not probably already making business plans that would enable them to capitalize on that, you know, very kind of wide-ranging ban. And I know people say, when I say that, people say, you know, oh, you only care about your own profits. Well, yeah, but for every €1 of profit that we lose to the black market, EU governments lose 13. So it's...
Okay, we'll come back to this. We've got a lot of ground to cover yet. But Christel Schaldemose, if I can come to you next. I mean, I know you're particularly keen to see that we stop young people from smoking, because 80% of hardened smokers start before they're 18. I must admit, I gave up a long time ago when I started, when I was about 13. So it is obviously something that needs to be addressed.
Definitely, and therefore I welcome the proposal from the Commission, because I believe that it is a step in the right direction. I don't think that we should target the older people who have been smoking for many years. I mean, They are addicted and it is difficult for them to stop, and they know the consequences anyway. But I believe that it is important to really do something for the young people, and therefore I agree with the Commission's proposal when it comes to how you pack the cigarettes, long, slim cigarettes, sends a signal to the young women that they can keep on being slim if they smoke, etc. And I believe that we should get rid of these kind of signals and have a clear message sent to the young people that it is dangerous to smoke, and we should do whatever it's possible for us to do in order to help them not begin smoking.
Okay, Flaminia Consuelo Tullia, you represent the tobacco retailers. I was speaking to a tobacco retailer in the UK who seems to think that, in fact, most of the young people who smoke are female, because they're young girls, because they see it as an aid to slimming. They see the supermodels all smoking, this sort of thing. I mean, do you find that there is a difference in the kind of customers that tobacconists have?
Well, thanks for inviting us, first of all. And then, yeah, to answer you, I would like to say exactly that. Well, the attitude of a smoker, the fact of starting smoking, depends from a wide range of reasons, which are in their psychological, social, depend on their psychological and social sphere. It depends on the group model, the social model, but I wouldn't say that a woman would smoke a slim cigarette because of the aspect, because for the contrary, the fact of smoking slim cigarettes would be because they would choose to smoke less. So I would never find it.
I just think it's very different from my day. When I started smoking, it was because most of my older friends did, and I was in a heavy industrial area of northeast England at the time. But before we progress any further, let's take a look now at this short report.
Smoking-related diseases are said to kill up to 700,000 people a year in the EU and cost around 25 billion euros in healthcare. Now, the European Commission is proposing tough new rules to discourage smoking. With 70% of smokers starting before they're 18 years old, it's important to catch them young.
We may convince the one or other smoker to stop, but the most important aim is prevent young people from starting to smoke.
Only in the UK and Italy are packets of 10 cigarettes available. Britain has the EU's second highest tobacco prices after Ireland, and under new UK laws, neither product nor prices can be displayed in supermarkets. But until 2015, they can in small shops.
The biggest difference is the PriceSmart packs, and obviously they can't sell them, we can, therefore we sell far more cigarettes than we ever did.
Under the new proposals, warnings and shocking pictures will cover 75% of cigarette and roll-your-own tobacco packs. A disincentive then, but taxes on cigarettes alone raise well over 75 billion euros each year for EU economies.
Cigarettes are always suspect in these terms, because many times they put the fiscal targets ahead of the public interest. This is the problem of Europe.
Meanwhile, those who sell tobacco products are unconvinced that larger, more horrific warnings will make hardened smokers quit.
Shock tactics for anything will work with a few people, but the hardcore people will just take no notice whatsoever, you know. Police are still doing drink-drive campaigns and people are still drinking and driving. People are how they are, in my opinion.
Indeed they are. Karl-Heinz Florenz, since smoking is known to be dangerous, it's known to kill people, I mean, 650,000 deaths, I think the Commission claims, 29% of all deaths in developed countries, why not an outright ban? Why are we doing this? Is this just because the government still need the duty?
Also, man kann das Rauchen nicht verbieten. Wenn erwachsene Leute rauchen wollen, dann muss man sie rauchen lassen. Die jungen Leute sollen nicht ans Rauchen kommen. Und was die Steuern angeht, da wird ja von der Seite der Tabakindustrie so einige mehr und einige Geschichten erzählt. In meinem Land ist das eindeutig so, dass die Steuereinnahmen bei 14 Milliarden liegen, aber die Gesundheitskosten bei 33. Also es ist ein dramatisches, negatives Spiel. Und ich möchte nochmal daran erinnern, dass in meinem Land jeden Tag 300 Menschen elend sterben. Da ist Leid, Kummer, Schmerz und Tränen hinter. Also ich bin schon erstaunt, dass in den Vereinigten Staaten ein Flugzeug stillgesetzt wird, nur weil es qualmt. Und bei uns in Europa verlieren wir jedes Jahr 700.000 Menschen und wir reagieren nicht mutig. Das ist schwach und das Parlament muss dagegen setzen. Man muss die Kirche im Dorf lassen, das will ich nicht bestreiten. Aber diese verführerischen Verpackungen wie Slim und Co., gut genug, dass es schon verboten ist und das kann man noch nacharbeiten.
Ronan Barry, I mean, that is the point, isn't it? It is known to be dangerous. You say yourself, your own company acknowledges that people die from smoking-related diseases. So why not a ban? Do you feel that this is hypocrisy on the part of the policymakers?
I don't think it's... I wouldn't characterize it as hypocrisy. Like, I think it's, you know, in general, you know, governments make a lot of money from taxing tobacco, but that doesn't conflict with their desire to reduce its overall consumption. I mean, what wouldn't make sense is if, you know, number one, a ban, and number two, any other regulations that move consumption from the legal to the black market means that they still have to contend with the public health issue without getting the revenue. I mean, that doesn't make sense in anyone's book, I would imagine. But I'd like to address some of the points, the suggestion that people smoke, or that slim cigarettes and other kinds of cigarettes may play a role in someone's decision to start smoking. I think consumers are a lot more sophisticated than that. I don't think any consumer, any non-smoker, decides to become a smoker because slim cigarettes are available. That to me is not credible, and the evidence suggests otherwise. The evidence is a very large body of evidence has been built up over many years that asks the question, why do people start to smoke? And it cites a whole variety of reasons. You mentioned one yourself earlier on, like peer pressure and parental influence and so on. It does not say that people start smoking because, you know, there are slims available. And the reality is, when you ban things for which people have a preference, for which there is a demand, you create a prohibition scenario, and you have and you fuel the black market as a result. So I think it's very important that I see a lot of what's in this directive as clamping down on consumer choice, and it would bring about a situation whereby you've got, you know, far less choice or almost no choice available to consumers on the legal market and lots of choice available on the black market. You know, it doesn't take too long to figure out who wins in that scenario.
Crystal Chaldemals, I mean, that is a valid point, isn't it? I know certainly of places where people go to certain cafes or certain public bars or whatever because they know that there's a chap in there who's got smuggled cigarettes. And sometimes they're not even very good cigarettes. They're clearly counterfeit cigarettes. I mean, isn't there a risk that this sort of action by the Commission is going to drive it underground, like as Ronan Barry said?
Well, of course, there is a risk that the illegal market will increase, at least in the beginning, when we make new things in order to prevent people from starting to smoke. But I have heard the Commission and the Commissioner saying that we also should target this, we should also address this problem. Mm-hmm. So, of course, we should do something in order to tackle the challenge from the illegal market, from the customs and the authorities in general. So I don't think that that's an argument for not doing anything here. I believe that we should, of course, tackle the challenges coming arising from the illegal market. But it, for me, it's not a question of then stopping doing anything about preventing young people from starting to smoke. And let me comment on the slim cigarettes again. Well, if you don't believe that it have an impact on the young people, the young ladies, women starting smoking, then why do you produce the slim cigarettes at all if it doesn't give any marketing advantages? So, I mean, for me, you could turn it the other way around. I believe that we should try to do everything in order to make it less attractive for young people to start smoking. And that is a question about the packaging, how it looks, the taste, and where you can buy it and how you can buy it. Of course, bigger warnings does not stop people who have been smoking for 20 years. No, I know that. But the warnings are not targeted for them. It's targeted for the young people starting smoking, and they see the pictures, etc. So I think we should talk about what is important here. And the important thing is to stop to prevent the young people from beginning to smoke at all.
Karl-Heinz Florenz, you're concerned about the counterfeiting issue as well, I know. This is the thing that Mr. Skylakakis was saying. He was appeared in the report there. He's very concerned about counterfeits.
Ja, natürlich haben wir Schmuggel, aber der Schmuggel ist ja nicht heute geboren oder er wird nicht geboren werden, wenn wir eine neue Verpackungsregelung in Europa schaffen, sondern er ist immer da gewesen und wir hätten uns vielleicht in Europa mehr darum kümmern sollen. Das sehe ich auch so. Aber zu glauben, nur weil die Verpackung anders wird, würde der Schmuggel größer werden, das ist mit blauäugig. Da ist einfach nichts dran. Und ich habe auch noch mal eine Frage oder einen Hinweis an die Tabakindustrie zu den Kosten. Wir streiten uns seit, ich bin jetzt 23 Jahre in dem Parlament und seit 23 Jahren streiten wir uns darüber. Mein Vorschlag ist, dass wir das Produzentenrecht, die Produzentenverantwortung in der Tabakbranche einführen und dass die Tabakbranche die tatsächlichen Kosten der Gesundheit übernimmt und diese Kosten dann richtigerweise auf die Zigaretten umschlägt. Und dann kostet natürlich die Packung das Dreifache. Aber da weiß auch jeder gleich, was er für seinen Gesundheitsbeitrag da hält. Und wir haben das in diesem Parlament in einer Resolution beschlossen. Der Kommissar Dalli, den wir schmerzhaft verloren haben, der hat das schon aufgegriffen in seinen ersten Schritten. Das kann man auch nicht in ein oder zwei Jahren umsetzen. Ich möchte die Kommission wirklich auffordern, diesen Gedanken wissenschaftlich prüfen zu lassen. Das Produzenten-Verursacher-Prinzip, das muss greifen. Dann weiß jeder, jawohl, meine Zigaretten kosten jetzt 15 Euro, aber davon sind 10 Euro Gesundheitskosten drin. Dann brauchen wir uns über diese Streitereien, wer nimmt was ein und so gar nicht unterhalten, dann sind die Fronten klar, es wäre eine wunderbare Idee.
Briefly, just a response for you, Ronan Barry.
Yeah, just quickly on that specific question that you asked. I mean, it's already the case that upwards of 80% of the price of a pack is tax. So, and as I mentioned already before, it's for every €1 of profit that the industry makes, governments make 13. So, the scenario you're describing is pretty much where we are, I think. But I would just like to very quickly address the points made about packaging and
briefly if you would, because
the evidence doesn't support the suggestion, and I think it's important not to base regulation on supposition and speculation. The evidence is clear that on what makes people smoke, and it's not the colour of a pack or the shape of a pack or any of these things. And just very quickly, a US Court of Appeal has looked at this in quite some detail, has examined the evidence from around the world on the impact on smoking, on overall smoking rates of enlarged pictorial health warnings. And the court concluded that there's not a shred of evidence, that's the court's words, not mine, not a shred of evidence that they reduce smoking.
Okay, so, Flaminia Consuelo Trilli, I'd like to come to you next. I mean, your people, all the tobacconists of Europe, demonstrated in Brussels not so long ago. 4,000 of them marched through Brussels. They didn't appear in the area just beside the parliament because the farmers led to a ban on all demonstrations taking place there. However, the claim was there are 25,000 jobs at risk. There are presumably social consequences to this too. It's not just that we're going to lose the little tobacco shops, which in France, for instance, and in Italy, I know, are where you buy stamps as well, unless you go to the post office. But also, I know of a lot of pubs in the UK are closing, and partly that is because of the smoking ban. The chaps who used to go there on a Saturday afternoon to watch the football now go to each other's houses with a case of lager bought from a supermarket. So what sort of social consequence do you see for your own members here?
Yeah, I agree with what you said about UK, and I can add as an example, just to introduce the problem, that in Belgium, for example, in a year and a half, we had 2,200 and more shops have closed because of the ban. Well, this is a logical consequence, but if we want to see what these kind of measures would have as an impact on our sector, well, first, it is not really worth trying to change the appearance of a shop, which thing that would happen with these ugly pictorials displayed behind the shoulders of the retailer. Imagine that you would have a whole wall of ugly pictures uglifying the shop.
But in the UK, they're actually just covered up. They're hidden behind shutters.
Yeah, but not in the specialised shops. So,
but that's the way to do it, you just to cover it up instead of...
Well, this would open another discussion on the, once again, hiding a product would push people, especially young people, to buy it more than. And in coming back to the retailer's activity, would be extremely attacked by these measures because of the daily problem that these standardization of the package, of the appearance of the package with cause. Every day the retailer would spend much more time in managing the stock, in reacting and helping the client. And this is a problem, and this is the only point of sale, tobacco point of sale, that is extremely regulated. It's a responsible activity. They only sell tobacco to adults, and so the rule.
That's been the rule in the UK for a long time. But when I was at school, people could still pop across. That was a long time ago. People could still pop across to the local shop and buy two cigarettes. And there are still plenty of retailers, I think, who in the UK at least. A few, at least, who will do that. It's illegal, but it will happen.
Anyway, within the union, half a million jobs would be in danger with this
half
kind
a million.
Of... Yeah,
half
if
a million,
we consider the whole member states, if we only talk about our members of CDT, it would be very impressive, too, as a figure, but also because they are all family-run businesses, specialized, hyper-specialized in the tobacco sale, 70% of their turnover sometimes come out of tobacco.
I'm afraid we're going to have to, non-effective measures. We really are going to have to cut this very short. I would like literally a one-sentence answer from each of you. For young people in particular, I mean, young people like to do things that are seen as being slightly illegal, slightly edgy, slightly dangerous. If we hide cigarettes away and make them harder to find, isn't that going to give them a kind of an appeal? Crystal Chaldemos.
No, I don't believe that. For some, for few, but I think hiding it away will make it more difficult for them to go out to buy the package just before they go to a party and in that respect start smoking. I believe we should do something. And let me just ask just one thing, because the tobacco industry says that, well, they recognize the fact that it is unhealthy to smoke, but still, you don't want to do anything at all. You don't want to have bigger warnings. You don't want to have plain packaging. You don't want to hide the tobacco away. You don't want to do anything.
I think I have a specific suggestion on that, and I think there is an opportunity in this directive to make a big impact. And the example I would give is that currently today, there are smokers, a lot of smokers around Europe, migrating from cigarettes to products that are significantly less harmful, which also deliver nicotine, such as e-cigarettes. And in Sweden, people have the option of migrating to snus, which is also significantly less risky than cigarettes.
But still risky.
So it's still risky, but I mean, it's less risky. So you reduce the overall... Why should smokers be denied the option to reduce their health risk? And I think this is a really unfortunate thing in this directive, that it makes it harder instead of easier for smokers to switch from cigarettes to products that are far less likely to cause them harm.
Just very, very briefly, Karl-Heinz Florenz, I mean, that is a point. It's an illegal product, so why are people being denied choice? Why should they be denied choice if they know the risks?
Also ich möchte nochmal auch darauf eingehen, dass die Pubs sterben in Großbritannien oder auch bei mir in Deutschland. Jawohl, sie sind gestorben, aber in den letzten 20 Jahren. In meinem eigenen Dorf hatten wir früher 3 oder 4 Kneipen und jetzt ist gar keine mehr da. Das lag überhaupt nicht an den Rauchern, sondern es lag daran, dass die Gesellschaft sich in ihren Lebensformen geändert hat, zu Hause mit Television und so weiter eine ganze Menge an Abwechslung hat. Diese Richtlinie, über die wir jetzt diskutieren, regelt nicht das Rauchen, ja oder nein, sondern die regelt das Inverkehrbringen von Tabakprodukten. Und da gibt es einige Bereiche, die ich unterstütze, nämlich verlockende Werbung zu machen. Da gibt es andere Vorstellungen der Kommission, die sogar vorschreiben, dass jede Schachtel nun wirklich ganz gleich aussehen muss. Also ob sie 8 cm breit sind oder 10 cm, da kann man nicht mehr drüber reden. Aber das oberste Gebot ist der Gesundheitsschutz von jungen Menschen. Und da ist die Kommission im Grundsatz richtig und die Tabakindustrie ist eigentlich gut beraten, da mitzuarbeiten. Und wenn Sie wenn Sie glauben, dass das alles nicht wirkt, dann brauchen Sie davor auch keine Sorge zu haben, weil dann wirkt es ja nicht auf Ihre Umsätze. Also machen Sie mit uns, ist viel besser, als gegen uns zu arbeiten.
Okay, Flaminia, just very briefly, it really has to be just in seconds, please. One thing that Sean Brown, the shopkeeper that you saw in that short report, said was that since cigarettes have been hidden in supermarkets, put away as they are under by the law in the UK, he'd been selling many more cigarettes because small shops are allowed to show them. So presumably hiding them could be seen as a way of reducing consumption.
No, as... As we've seen, the problem would be that they will be buying cigarettes from in an easier way on the illicit market.
Okay,
this is the Irish experience and the Canadian one.
Okay. I'm really sorry, we've really got to leave it. That's all we've got time for, I'm afraid. It looks those of anti-smoking campaigns will go on into the foreseeable future, but despite having to go outside to do it these days, hardened smokers will take a lot of stopping. My thanks to my guests, Karl-Heinz Florenz, to Christel Schaldemoser, Ronan Barry, and of course to Flaminia Consuelo Trillia, and of course to you for watching. Thank you and goodbye.